environment variables within the container, it will have these two environment variables available. Special underscore level will be vary and special underscore type. So your program, whatever the program is, may it be Nginx or any other program you write, can access this environment variables and act accordingly. So this is a very simple example of it. It could be a file, right? So if it's a file, you can mount it to a particular location. So your container will remain the same, but in a particular location, wherever you have mounted it, it will have that values. So your application can act according to it. So you can change the configuration of your application to act. This is one of the applications. Similar to config maps, there's another concept called secrets. That when Mudit was explaining, he was showing something called a secret, right? What is that? It's very similar to config maps. It's just that more confidential values like certificates, which you don't want people to see. You generally put it there. And Kubernetes has some ways where it handles it more securely than config maps. That's about it. Any questions on config maps? Okay. So let's take an example, right? Okay. So let's say you know about Nginx? Okay. So okay, let's consider an application you are writing which has a particular username password, right? So it needs to connect to a database, and the database has a username password. You deploy it in one of the environments. It will have one username password. Whereas if you deploy it in another environment, there you might want to specify a different username password. It's the same container image running in both the location, but it requires different configuration. How do you specify that? So that is where it comes into play. So this is a configuration which was manually created. So it depends on your application, special type and special level or some example things. It can be anything that you want. So the other example is certificates. For a different, host, you will have a different host name. And based on that, the TLS certificate will look differently. So that is on config maps, and then let's go to health check. So health check is one of the key essential features which helps make sure the application is stable, right? So we talked about how Kubernetes has a state. It has an intended state where it wants the Kubernetes cluster to be and the application to be in, and then there is this existing state and it changes, right? So now it needs to know whenever a container is healthy or when it is not healthy, right? So what do we do in general cases, right? If you are deploying a normal application in a particular VMs or other machines, whenever something goes wrong, you have to go debug it and fix it. But how many of you have seen the serial called IT Cloud? Have you ever heard of it? Okay. Yeah, so there is a famous phrase in it, like whenever the IT Cloud is about a service organization, IT service organization, and whenever any of them complain about anything, right, the first thing they take is not hello. They say, did you switch it off and switch it on? So just restarting things helps, right? Whenever we are stuck with some problem, we just reboot the machine. We don't care about it. That is where containers come into picture, right? Containers allow for that. You cannot reboot a machine which is having tens of applications running as a monolith. You have to go through so much configuration. But in container, you just kill one, create one. So that paradigm shift changes it, right? So whenever something is unhealthy, you can restart it. Now, the question comes, how do you identify something is unhealthy? So there are two ways. Your containers, as you saw yesterday, is processes. We have a set of processes. Whenever the process is not active, it can identify the container is not healthy and it can kill it off and create a new one. But not always that happens, right? Like you might have written an application which has been running for 10 days, and due to garbage collection or memory out of memory or something, it might have gone into a stale state. If you look at the process, yes, the process is alive. But can it serve requests? No. How do you identify those situations? And that is where health check comes into picture. And Kubernetes has two main concepts, which is liveliness check and readiness check, which allows to identify that. So what is liveliness check? So liveliness check allows you to check if the application is alive or not. So it could be an endpoint that you define in your application, which says, if I get a successful response from this endpoint, I am alive. right? And the container is alive. So the if, let's say there is a, even though the process is running, if it's not able to respond to it, the system will not consider that the application is alive. If it is not alive, it just identifies that, kills it, and restarts it. But if you're considering a big application, which might have a lot of things to load in the cache, let's say as soon as the application starts, it reads from 10 configuration files, 10 things, which might take a few seconds, you may not want to restart it, right? It will just keep killing it and starting it. It will become a recursive loop. How do you avoid that? And that's where readiness checking comes into picture. So you have a container which is started, and then it is doing this preloading. So liveliness check will be successful at that time. And then you have to create something called readiness check, which says, okay, now I can serve requests. I have done whatever preloading I have to do, and I can start serving requests. So it waits till the point where the readiness check succeeds. Only then the service will start routing the queries to it, like all the REST services till then will be blocked. So if there are 10 services, two of them readiness check is failing, eight of them is successful, it is redirecting the request to the other eight till these two give successful messages. And it's not only when the pod actually starts up, it is always, right? When the application is running, it is serving 10 requests, let's say. And then it is busy with serving them. So you can choose to have the readiness check not answer the request, right? Not answer successful message. Then the new request will not be coming. So it's not getting overloaded. So this liveliness check and readiness check allows you to communicate to Kubernetes whether your application is running properly or not. And though in this examples we see that, okay, do a HTTP GET request and see in this port and see whether it is successful. And what should be the failure threshold? After how many failures should I consider it to be a real failure? And between two requests, how much time should I spend? That is period seconds that you specify. So in most cases, it's good to have both. So liveliness check tells Kubernetes that the container is healthy. But it might or might not be able to serve requests, right? So for example, a database base process is up, but it might have to start some auxiliary processes. So between those two, the liveliness check might be up, readiness check might be a failure. So it depends on your application. That's just a sample endpoint that we have specified. It could be anything. You can have it slash health check, health slash whatever you want. So it is if it is a REST call, you take a application, right? It has a IP and a port. Right? After that, what is the relative path? So it's a relative path after that. That's what it's. So this is one of the ways to do it. So HTTP GET is one of the ways. It could also check whether there is a file existing in that file system. If that file exists, it considers it healthy. If it's not exists, it might consider it unhealthy. Or it could be a TCP port. There are many other definitions of it. We are not covering all of them in this example. Okay, so this is the health check. This enables the system to be communicate to Kubernetes the health of it and so make the system stable. But generally, it is advised you can club all of them into a single one too, right? You can write an application in such a way that it checks all of them before it says whether it's successful or not, so that you are not overloading with multiple requests.
Are these health checks actually provided for all the ports that are open or?
It's up to you. Right, so you can have a single port which monitors every other port and make sure that it's reporting successful or not. It's up to you to define how you want to.
This check is for a container, not for a pod.
It is for a container, yes. So this is just a portion of the YAML file. So this will become part of the pod definition. Okay, so let's move on, right? So the other thing that you might have noticed when Mudit was explaining about the YAML file on deployment, right? It had something called resources and requests, right? So there are two concepts, requests and limits. This allows the definition to specify what should be the starting resources that the container or the pod should be given, right? And also, what is the maximum it should be allowed to take? So that request is something that says, okay, this is the minimum I need to start with. And then limits says, this is the maximum of this container or a pod should be allowed to take. Anything above that, it will get killed. It will not be given to it, right? And that is defined in terms of millicores and the megabytes, right, or gigabytes, however you want to. So here, that's where the question, your question was, right, on millicores. So essentially, M here that you see in the CPU stands for millicores, which is basically you take a core and consider it as 1,000 cores, 1,000 millicores, right? You split it into 1,000. And then you say, okay, this container should be allowed to take only 500 millicores, nothing more than that. Anything more than that, it will not be given. So let's, how it works, it uses time sharing essentially. Like you cannot use the same core exactly at the same time. So only 500, yeah. So that's how it does. And then similarly, you have this memory, right? Memory, it says, okay, this is the amount of memory this container can take. It can be in megabytes or gigabytes, any of those terms. And request is given to it, and then limit stops it from using more than that. Any questions on that? So that's for monitoring, right? So this is for limiting. So okay, you are defining a pod, how much it should be given, and how much it should be allowed to. So Stackdriver, I think it's for monitoring, like what is the current usage and others. So there are many other tools like Prometheus and Grafana which can monitor them. Okay, so let's move on to the next concept. Auto scale, right? Okay, so we were talking about replicas and auto scalers quite a bit, and this might be a good opportunity for us to understand what exactly they are. Replicas, right? What are replicas? In a deployment, when we put something called a replica and say 5 replicas, you put a static number there. It says for this particular deployment, always maintain 5 replicas of this particular pod. So irrespective of what is happening anywhere, it just maintains 5. It does not care, okay, is the 5 overloaded? Is it underloaded? It does not care about it, right? So it gives a static number which says maintain this. Auto scale, on the other hand, is like, okay, depending on the load, increase the number of replicas or decrease the number of replicas to cater to the current load requirements. So that is the difference. Is that difference clear? So you generally don't use replicas when you're using the auto scale, right? It's a different concept. You generally use auto scale to define what the number of replicas scaling should be when the resource utilization is different. So, and auto scalers are of different types. What we talk about as auto scaling generally is horizontal pod auto scaler. So let's look at what is the difference between these three auto scalers. When you have created a cluster, right, you are giving it particular set of nodes. Let's say you have 10 nodes given to your cluster. It's a fixed resources, right? In that case, there is no scope for really scaling. You have those resources, let's utilize all those resources. But this cluster autoscaler allows you to scale the nodes itself. So you can specify when the total disk pressure or the RAM utilization is above this or below this, increase or decrease your number of nodes in such a way that the utilization is maintained this much. So that is cluster autoscaler. So which is increasing or decreasing the infrastructure itself that is available to the cluster. Yeah, there are ways to specify it. We are not going into the details today in this call, but because there is a definition, so there are multiple types of implementations, and each implementation would take a different shape. So there is a horizontal pod autoscaler, which cluster autoscaler, which is part of Kubernetes, which has its own definition language. We can look at that. Yeah, but this is for the cluster. So this is for the infrastructure and not for things running inside the infrastructure. So the YAML to which you specify it might be slightly different. It's not the deployment YAML, right? Or you could write commands which can even do it, right? So that is a cluster autoscaler. This scales the infrastructure. And the second is a horizontal pod autoscaler. So pod autoscaler is what we generally talk about. We have a set of replicas. How many replicas should be there? If the total CPU utilization is more than 50%, like maintain the CPU utilization at 50%, let's say, right? And then the, you said this is the minimum number of replicas I can go to, this is the maximum number of replicas I can go to. Say you say 5 and 10. Between these two numbers, it will automatically scale up or scale down to maintain that average CPU utilization or RAM utilization. So that is how this works. So that is a horizontal pod autoscaler. So you create a replica and then you create multiple copies of it, reduce the copies of it. So node does not come into consideration because it is at the, so it can place it in across all the nodes too. Whatever resources it is available to it, it can use them. I think it's at a pod level, not probably at a container. Yeah, I think it's. So generally what happens is in a pod, only one of this is a main container. Right, everything else is using auxiliary, but if look at the average utilization at the pod level, I can confirm. In this case it's at deployment level. We'll look at an example of it. And then there is this vertical pod auto scaling. So vertical pod auto scaling, we talked about limits and requests, right? So we have this limit. This is a limit. We specify to your deployment and say, okay, this is the maximum amount of resources this pod can take. But there might be situations where you might want to give it more resources rather than creating a new instance of a container or a pod. So that's when vertical pod autoscaling comes into picture. You say, if the maintain the CPU or RAM utilization at a certain level, if it is not, increase the limit to the, up to this much. Generally, horizontal pod autoscaler and vertical pod autoscaler are not used together. It's either this or that. That's how it is generally used.
So can I do first, let's say, my CPU is going beyond something,
and I go for
vertical pod autoscaler first, and then even then, like, if I reach the maximum limit, then can I opt for horizontal?
It depends on the capability of the autoscaler. So Kubernetes is like a bunch of capabilities that are brought together. So and you can take different implementations of each one of them. So horizontal pod autoscaler has different implementations across the different distributions. So you have to base it on that.
So when people autoscaling,
does a container or pod get restarted? So for example, right now I was at this limit, and now when I'm increasing the limit, I'm updating the deployment file. When you're using vertical pod autoscaling, it is a scheduler which is taking care of things for you. Scheduler or the controller, the vertical autoscaler controller is taking care of, and that increases it. But how it affects it in the current implementation, which is in Kubernetes, it actually restarts because that is the only way containers allow it for it to be scaled up right now. So you create a new container which has a bigger limit and kill the old container. So placement is taken care of by the scheduler. So where it places in the container is a different question. So here it just says, okay, I will increase the limit. And after that, the scheduler takes a decision whether to place it in the same node or in a different node. It might be in the same node or in a different node. Okay, so this is the hardware capacity available for the pod, right? So when you specify a limit, you are saying, okay, this is the maximum you can use, of which you have used 50%. So it is within that. Are you 50% there or are you 60% within the limit? So in the same node have more capacity, but this container is not allowed to use that. So for the particular pod, it is always limited to what its limits are. So in horizontal pod autoscaler, there is no infrastructure extension at all. So it is only the number of replicas are increased within the same infrastructure.
So would it actually require some resources?
There might be extra resources that are available. So or some other container which was using more resources might be now using lesser resources. So it is available for it. Or both might go hand in hand. So horizontal pod autoscaler comes into play. It increases the resources, and then the cluster autoscaler notices that it does not have enough resources to consume. So it will create a new node. So both will play hand in hand. Only the horizontal pod autoscaler and vertical pod autoscaler might not be compatible, because if you are allowed to increase the limits, then it will always be 50%. How will horizontal autoscaler come into play? Yes.
So if there is no replica, the service will have a downtime.
It will provision a new and then kill the first.
So all that care is being taken.
Yes.
Some
directive I think it's automatically taken care of, mostly in autoscalers.
For scaling down, again it could require a restart.
Scaling down is anyway killing. You need not start something. You just kill a container, that's it. Oh, scaling down in vertical autoscaler,
yes.
It will be restart, yes. Okay, so this is how you specify a horizontal pod autoscaler definition, right? So this is a command. There might be YAML definitions to do it, but essentially it says that maintain the CPU utilization at 50%. And the minimum number of CPUs, minimum number of replicas at 1 and maximum at 10 for the deployment and named Nginx. Right? So this is how you generally specify a horizontal pod autoscaler definition. And then the system automatically takes care of it for you. Which capacity?
Nodes capacity, because we are scaling at the pod level.
So let's say you are at 9 and you want to provision 10, but there is node is not able to specify. This will keep retrying.
Okay.
If the cluster autoscaler comes and provisions new, yes, it will have available. Or if other containers start consuming less resources, it will become available, then it will get started. So that is why the declarative model comes into picture. It's always monitors and acts. So there is no event, right? It has, I need to scale up now, and then if I don't get it to it, it's gone. It's not like that. It's a declarative model. You need to constantly monitor to bring it to that state.
So just whenever you are starting a new pod, so it can happen at a different node also, horizontal.
It can happen in any nodes, yes.
So it's not retrying in the same node?
Not necessarily.
The
scheduler decides, okay, this is the node which has the least, the most resources, so let's schedule in that. Okay, so let's go on. Okay, rolling update. So we talked about containers being restartable, right? And that allows for a feature where you can update your application with no downtime. So if you look at most of our banking websites and stuff, what happens is that you have a maintenance period. Oh, they're saying, I'm updating my core banking system, so I expect a downtime of 3 days or 4 days, right? So what this rolling update allows for is, since we have microservices, and if we write the microservices the right way that one version and the other next version are compatible with each other, why can't I update the system with zero downtime? How do I achieve that? So you have a container. You have replicas, right? You have 10 replicas of the container. You want to update it to a new version. So you start a new one already. So you have more replicas with some being new, some being old. And then once that becomes healthy, kill the old ones. So let's see an example here, right? So let's consider this as a current deployment. You have a deployment which has 4 replicas and spread across multiple nodes exposed with a service. And then you want to change the image from version 1 to version 2, right? You're telling it to set the image to image version 2, right? And what happens is a new container with a new IP address is getting created to replace this updated app. So it creates a new one, and once it becomes healthy, it kills the old one. Similarly, do it for another pod, and then it replaces the entire thing. So incrementally update it so that there is no downtime. Like your requests are going to be routed to the old one first, and when new things come, it gets increasingly routed to the new one. So with no downtime, you can update your entire application. And that's how most of your, like, you might not see such things in Facebook or Google or any of them, because they are just doing a rolling update. So similarly, if there is a failure, you can do a rollback. So let's say that the one of the containers is failing. As soon as it creates a new container, you will realize that, okay, it cannot start because there is an error or there's a bug. So I don't let it replace all the existing containers. So of the four, the two are replaced, and then I realize that it's not working, I just do a rollback. It stops this rollout and then reverts back. So it allows you for a continuous integration, which leads to a seamless 100% uptime. Any questions on this? Okay. So this too? So essentially, this is what is happening, right? So whenever a new version, this purple color is a new version, and then this green, blue color is the old version. So yeah, the purple color one is created, and then the green one is, and then here also the green is replaced by purple. Here the other new two pods, there are four pods, it's just replacing one after the other. The last two, in the last case, all the four are in the latest version. Okay, so that is rolling update. Now let's look at another concept called Helm. So you might have noticed till now that you are using so many YAML files, right? For a deployment, there is a YAML. For specifying a PVC, there will be a YAML. For specifying anything, there will be a YAML file. Like a config map is a YAML. You're dealing with tens of hundreds of YAML files. The moment you get there, it can get unmanageable when you're talking about a 100 container application or a 100 microservice application. How do you enable hosting this in a scalable manner? And that, if you have noticed the timeline, there was a point I was saying that there was a package manager which is called Helm became available at some point. And what this package manager does is it brings together all the YAML files we saw into a single cluster of a package, right? So it creates a folder structure which is similar to this, right? My chart is a chart name. It's called a chart in here, Helm chart. And then there's a chart.yaml file which has some metadata about the application. And then the values.yaml file, which has some parameters about the application. It says that, okay, I'm running in this particular environment. This is my host name and any other configuration. I want five replicas of this. So what it does is essentially, and then the files, all the files that you talked about, like a config map file in here, it parameterizes the different parts which needs to be changed across the various deployments. So in the config map file you saw sometime back, you had all these values written down as specific values. And in this file, you see that all these are parameterized within the brackets. So it takes these values from the values.yaml and changes it for a particular deployment. So you have 50 files which share the same value. You need to change all the values before you deploy to your new cluster. To avoid that, you parameterize that, put all the parameters which needs to be changed into your values.yaml, and then create this chart. And you can essentially take 100 YAML files and have just a single configuration file called values.yaml, which changes only the configurable values, and you can deploy it. So right now, as of today, there is a Helm version 3 available. So all it does is essentially, it's just a local binary that sits in your laptop. Similar to how kubectl works, it just changes, when you run it, it just changes all the files that, template files that it got, all the config map, replaces all the parameters, and does similar to what kubectl is doing, right? It changes all the parameters and applies the configuration. So when you are handling a bigger application, the Helm charts generally come in handy for you to work with. So you can read about the Helm charts online, and when you are trying to deploy a bigger application, try using that. Right? So that's what we will be covering in the lecture two. So I think the concepts you looked at today in the first two lectures helps you deploy an application in a production level, like scaling with all the configuration parameters, PVCs helps you do the storage. And what we will do in the upcoming lab session is that we will try to bring an application called Acme Air, which has many of these components, and see how it works. Any questions? Okay, so let's switch over to the lab. So you can go back to the Git repository link, and you will see the instructions for lab 3. So how many of you have done all the way till lab 2, like all the commands finished? Okay, let me ask, this is a good number, that's good to see. Who is facing difficulty? Is there anybody who needs help? Sure. You need some. Okay. So we will come to you and we will help you out. Do you have a break? We'll just start in a minute.